Hello, in this video I want to share with you some teachings and practices related to understanding and transforming fear and exploring our shadow side. So, fear is basically what stops us from living our full potential, from going for what we love. But do we really understand what fear is? We know it's something that is like a resistance in us, which is like a brake. So we have the gas pedal, we have the brake, and the fear is like a brake in our system. And we think, well, it's good we have fear because then we don't do too dangerous things. Now, it might be a good idea to question those ideas because fear is very much a mental process related to worst case scenario thinking. Whereas the capacity to protect ourselves against danger is an essence quality of awareness, of strength, of courage, and a natural instinct of self-preservation. So, for instance, if I have no fear and I'm faced with a car driving straight toward me, it doesn't mean I won't do anything. In fact, without fear, I will more likely quickly move out of the situation. I don't need fear. We tend to misunderstand mobilizing life energy for protection and call it fear. We call excitement fear. But actually, fear is, generally speaking, a mental process where I imagine a worst case scenario and then my body is mobilized as if it's already happening. And if this is intense, it not only mobilizes my body, but it immobilizes my body. It stops me and it stops my thinking, and I'm no longer able to see clearly and act wisely. So we don't actually need fear. We need the capacity to mobilize for protection. Often, a tool to transform fear is when you think you're afraid, ask yourself, am I afraid or am I simply excited? Am I afraid or am I simply mobilized? If you're going up in front of 1,000 people to hold a presentation, your body is mobilized. If you call it fear, it becomes easily a self-confirming process. Your fear generates more fear because the fear is a mental process. And the more you think about possible disastrous consequences, the more your body reacts. And then the more you start to think about disastrous possible consequences. And before you know it, your whole system capacity locks down. So, is what I'm feeling excitement, mobilization, capacity, strength, or is it fear? As first most powerful tool in how to deal with fear. Second tool to deal with fear, very powerful, is to ask, what is the worst that could happen? And then, when the answer comes, ask, well, if that happens, what is the worst that could happen? So, we actually, instead of reacting to some vague idea about the worst case scenario, we actually put our head into the lion's mouth. We go to our greatest fear. We dig, we excavate, we do some archaeological exploration until we get to the deepest fear. For instance, many of us, myself included, are afraid of showing our full passion, our wildness, our emotions, our sexual energy to the world. We try to be civilized and, behave properly. So we reduce our wildness. We are civilized, proper people. Now, in some cases, this, of course, is highly intelligent and appropriate. However, how much does that idea and attitude and habit limit my life, your life, where actually your wildness, your passion would be welcomed, would be celebrated, would be a gift, and most of all, a gift to you? So, you're in a situation where a lot of passionate energy is wanting to express itself in the public setting. And then, oh, wait a minute, you stop yourself. I stop myself. Oh. Because I'm afraid of the consequences. Now, if I don't explore, I don't even know why I stopped myself. I just say, oh, I got afraid, and that's why I stopped. But you didn't stop because you were afraid. You became afraid because you were thinking about the worst case scenario without actually being aware of what you're thinking. So when I have this fear reaction, I say, okay, what's the worst that can happen if I show my passion in this context, on the dance floor, in this setting? Well, some people might find me a bit too much. Okay. So, if some people find you too much, what's the worst that can happen? Well, then they might not like me. Okay, and if they don't like me, what's the worst that can happen? And so on. And then we get to the bottom of our greatest fear, and then we realize, can I live with that consequence? Yes. I discover, well, if it happens, it happens. I can live with it. But the normal effect is to see that's extremely unlikely. It's a fantasy which has almost no foundation in reality. And as we see that, either I can live with it and or it has no real foundation in reality. Then I say, well, I might as well do it. And then I can add, what is the consequence on my life if I don't follow my heart, if I don't allow my passion to be expressed, my wildness? And then I explore that and I discover the consequences of that is highly probable, like 99% probable. And the disastrous consequence of that is as big as the very unlikely disastrous consequence of the option of actually doing it. So that's the second powerful tool on fear. Now, there is one aspect of fear which is a shock response in the body. So, when we get a fear response, which is not just, oh, I'm feeling a bit scared for this, I'm shaking a little bit, it's a more intense reaction. Now, this we need to recognize is a shock response. The difference here is our brain shuts down. Because the shock response mobilizes the survival mechanism of the body, shuts down the thinking brain, puts us in reptile mode, where basically we are an animal only geared at survival. And we don't need our cognitive functions so much, or at all. So, in that situation, if I can recognize I'm in a shock reaction and I can tell myself, okay, I'm in a shock reaction. So now what we need to do is to find our resources before we can do anything else. First of all, I recognize I'm in a shock reaction, and that's okay. No judgment about it. Everybody has it. It is a normal thing. Step two. Take my time, breathe, and tell myself I'm in shock, but I'm safe. I'm in shock, but I'm safe. Confirming to myself I'm safe. Noticing my breathing, going slow, and then look for some connection to external reality. Look at something. You need to think that you want to turn on the cognitive brain. You want to get out of pure survival mode. So you look at a flower and say, that's a flower. That's a wall. That's the blue sky there. Oh, that's my hand. Take your time. Just come back to this place, this moment, because a shock reaction is related to the past. By connecting with here and now, I get out of this identification with the past. and my body functions start to come back. They start to come back. And then I add some focus on resources. I ask myself, am I safe right now in this moment? Yes. Which part of my body is most relaxed? I put my attention there. Who can I think about that adds strength to me? A friend, family member, or where can I think about a place? So I connect with some resources. As the resources come back, my cognitive brain switches on, and then I can go to normal fear management, the previous two tools. So, fear is a shock reaction, or it's a mental worst case scenario. Now there's a third tool related to fear, and that is to remember that fear can be your guide, fear can be your helper. Fear is related to the inner critic, to conditioning. We have been conditioned that certain things are right, other things are wrong, certain things are good, other things are bad. And there is a punishment if you do the wrong and bad thing. And there is a reward if you do the right and good thing. This is all baked into our inner critic. So as we step beyond conditioning, as we step beyond our present expression of our potential, we are stepping out of the conditioned zone, you could say, our limited programmed self, personality. And it is automatically triggering fear because it activates the superego, the inner critic, that has as a function to keep you within that form, wants to keep you safe, making you fit in by staying in this shape. So whenever we step outside, there is fear. So if I think of fear in this way, I can realize the moment I feel fear is a signal, in many, many cases, maybe most cases, that I'm now stepping into growth. Fear is a signal I'm growing. So if you feel fear about something, it means that's a good direction to move. So fear can tell you not where, what to stay away from, but the opposite. Fear tells you where to go. You see an attractive person, you want to have a relationship, and you think of asking this person for going for lunch together. Fear comes up. Thoughts about, oh, they won't like me, this person will reject me, etc. I feel fear. This fear tells me it's the right thing to do. Go and ask. That's where my growth is. Not only is that where my growth is, but that where is more fun life is, outside that comfort zone. So in that way, fear, even the thought of fear, tells me where to go, what to do. It doesn't tell me what not to do, it tells me what to do. If you're fear of speaking in groups, that's where your growth is. So if you're interested in growth, if you're interested in full potential living, fear tells you where to go and what to do. So this is an understanding and a tool to see that fear is my friend, fear is my guide. Now there's one thing we need to remember, which is again related to shock. And that is, if we follow the fear, we do what fear tells us not to do, we go in that direction, we have to have the wisdom to not go into the shock zone. We can play with the limit, but to be aware that if we jump too far, too fast, and our reaction is shock, then we may be stressing our system unnecessarily. It's not a disaster. We can use that as an opportunity to familiarize ourselves with shock, to heal our shock. The tendency when we do this unconsciously is to go too far. for instance, people who have been growing up in violent circumstances, in a war situation or in a violent family with alcoholic parents who beat them up, etc., they have an exaggerated tendency to be drawn to very dangerous situations, like be a correspondent in Iraq, in Syria, to go and work in South Sudan. It's like the shock in our system wants to be healed, wants to face, and healing happens when we face those suppressed feelings, and then we take it too far unconsciously, and we're simply stressing our system too much. We can't really integrate, digest, and no healing is happening. In fact, healing becomes more difficult because we're constantly stressing our system too much. So this is a wisdom. Yes, I follow my fear. I do what I'm afraid of. But I don't go too far. So in this day where Tantra workshops and sexual exploration workshops are so popular, one has to be really wise because some teachers do not have that awareness to a very large extent, or they ignore it, or in any case, a lot of people, they want to explore and go beyond their limited habits around sexuality, and then they go too far, and the result is the system doesn't really, the heart doesn't really open. It seems to open in what we do, but a big vulnerable part of us actually closes down more. We may be more free, it looks like, but inside we're actually more terrified, more closed. So we get less access to the most tender parts of ourselves. So this is an awareness which is really good to have, because teachers in that field don't necessarily have it. So we need to take responsibility. How far do I want to go? Have this awareness of shock. So these are some key tools around fear. We also have to remember that fear is very strongly related to the inner critic and the feeling of shame and guilt. The inner critic, the superego, is trying to keep us within a very limited version of ourselves so that we are fitting in, we are safe, and we belong. Now, the means of the superego inner critic is very much judgment, harsh judgment, self-judgment, and this causes the feeling of shame, which is a contraction of our life force, shutting down of our system, highly uncomfortable, shame and guilt. And since we want to avoid the feeling of shame and guilt, we avoid anything that might activate our inner critic. So the work on fear needs to go along with understanding the inner critic, and which goes along with understanding that the feeling of contraction, shame, and guilt is a symptom of an inner critic attack most of the time. And it can feel like a shock in our system, but it is a reaction to this harsh judgment inside. If we can learn to say yes to that feeling, then we can say, okay, this is highly uncomfortable. I must be under the attack of an inner critic. I need to defend myself. I need to disengage from this attack, because I'm now identified with being a small, afraid, vulnerable child under the attack of some big force. The reality is, it's just a tape recorder in my head. It's an old program. I'm not a child. I'm a grown-up. But the reaction is like that. I recognize it. Okay, I'm under attack. How can I defend myself? So that's a whole package of tools we can use, depending on how present we are. If we are in strong presence, we can just recognize the attack, see it as the attack, and disengage by pure presence. Just, okay, this is just an attack. if we're not that present, we may need to use some force. We may say, no, we need to use some strength. We need to access some aggression and actually use it against the attack. It's a stop. It's a no. It's not a counterattack. It's more like, no, I'm defending my tender soul against this harsh attack. Go. I'm not listening to this. It's a positive use of aggression. When we succeed with that, we access all the energy that was caught up in the attack and used against ourselves. We can use humor. We can say, go have a coffee break. I'm not listening to you. It begins with recognizing the symptoms of an attack, listening to what is the actual attack, and say, no, I'm not believing in this. There's nothing I should do or be. I'm here. I honor this moment, my experience here. That's the truth, the reality, and I honor it and I protect it. Self-protection. That's a whole package of teachings on the inner critic, which is necessary if we are going to deal with fear. So much fear is fear of these feelings of shame. Unconscious, I just keep myself limited, so I won't trigger the inner critic, which will trigger shame. Get comfortable with feeling shame, feeling guilt. This is a symptom of inner critic attack, nothing else. It doesn't mean I'm a bad person. It means I need to defend myself. So the benefit of this work on fear is I start to live according to my heart, according to my true longing, according to my passion. I start expanding the unfoldment of my true potential can be allowed to roll. And I will not be able to know where that will take me. Life will become an adventure of growth, an openness to grow, to explore, to try out, to experiment, to be open to the moment, to honor my vulnerable, tender soul. All these things, to be present in the moment, to connect deeply with people, to see the vulnerability of other people, to have compassion for the inner critic and fear of other people, to be able to support them with good questions and tools. So many benefits. So these are some teachings and tools related to fear, inner critic. And I want to add, our shadow material, everything we're not conscious of, everything we don't want to feel from early childhood has been suppressed and repressed and hidden away. Now, this is like a big shadow. It's everything we were taught to be afraid of showing and having in our system. All of it ended up in our shadow. Now, this big shadow is like a huge bag full of stuff that we don't know what's in it. But we have like a vague fear. Something's terrible there. It's terrible. And it can be terrible because if you stuff some instinctual energies and drives into that bag, they will rot. Anger will become rage, will become hate. Yes, there may be some pretty intense stuff in that shadow. So we're walking around in fear of our own shadow. Help, help. So what to do? We need to slowly open the lid and work with our shadow material if we want to really transform fear, because we know there's stuff in there. We don't know what it is, but unless we slowly open it and digest it step by step, fear will always be a companion in our life, because there's a huge bag of stuff in our shadow. And it will always give us an uncomfortable, unclear, vague, fuzzy fear of something dangerous will happen. I'm not in control. I'm not in charge. And it's true. How to get in charge, open the bag, take out piece by piece, feel, explore, show, deal with it. It will bring up fear, but it can be fun, because the more we do it, the more the energies which are caught up, 80% of our life energy, 70%, 90%, who knows, all that energy becomes available to live my life, to allow my potential to unfold. And in my view, it's all a long process with no final end goal. It's life. And we can help each other, and we need each other if we want to work through this. So, good luck, enjoy, and hope to see you soon.